Good morning to you all. Many thanks to Monty and Rachel and all the organizers of this conference for inviting me to be here today. I'm very glad to be here. In his essay, Schoenberg Reminiscences from 1951, Gerhard recalled the cultural effervescence of Berlin in the second half of the 20s, at the time he was there. Gerhard admired the work of Bertolt Brecht and Marlene Dietrich, Georg Grosst and Erwin Piscator, and the members of the Bauhaus school. In the field of music, he wrote, those years saw the first impact of jazz. Ragtime, foxtrot, shimmy, blues, and Charleston were the rage. The reign of the saxophone and the percussionist had begun. Kurt Weill with his Dreigroschenoper and Der Zarlässig Fotografieren, and Ernst Krenek with Johnny Spielt auf and Leben des Ores cast it on the craze. No other climate could have produced such works as Hindemith, Neues vom Tage, or Schoenberg's Von heute auf morgen. The first impact of politics on art, Hanns Eisler mock lyric newspaper cuttings, or his marching song for workers. Hindemith wrote easy pieces for amateur musicians and Wir bauen eine Stadt, Weill's cantata Der Lindenflug. These modernizing trends by German creators from all disciplines, born like Gerhard around 1900, were called then in the 1920s and also today the Neue Sachlichkeit or the new objectivity. The Neue Sachlichkeit was the German post-war reaction against expressionism and the notions of artistic elitism and autonomy of art. The Neue Sachlichkeit can be seen as the leftist and much more politically engaged counterpart to French and Spanish neoclassicism. In the first part of my presentation, I discuss how these trends, the Neue Sachlichkeit, influence Gerhard's thinking, his aesthetic thought. And in the second part, I will see how the Neue Sachlichkeit had an impact on his creative output. Shortly after returning to Barcelona in 1929, Gerhard published several articles in which he called for an end of the elitism of musical modernism and criticized the bourgeois concert hall as an institution, I quote, dead and detached from the spiritual and practical necessities of our time. Gerhard praised the functional music of Paul Hindemith and Kurt Weill, the music composed to be played outside the concert hall, and Gerhard called Spanish composers to follow the example of Hindemith and Weill. These ideas of Gerhard contrasted to a large extent to those advocated by most Spanish composers and music critics of Gerhard's generation, most prominently perhaps the influential critic Adolfo Salazar. Gerhard admired the theater music of Hindemith, Krenek, and especially Kurt Weill. From a notebook of the Berlin years, we know that he analyzed in detail this opera, Cardillac. Gerhard's interest in Kurt Weill's theater music is evidenced by the contents of his library. Gerhard owned the scores of these five stage works by Kurt Weill, but remarkably, none by other young German composers of Gerhard's generation. In 1929, Gerard said that he had chosen a theater play, Undetermined theater play, which he wanted to set into music, but only, he wrote, if he was able to give this work a completely new musical form. And I think he was thinking on the theater, musical theater of these composers, Kurzweil and others of his generation. But it doesn't appear that Gerard went on with this, or went ahead with this project of composing, of setting a musical play, a theater play into music. Gerard also praised Eisler's anti-bourgeois choral works for workers and the communist cantata Die Maßnahme by Eisler. Surprisingly, Gerard encouraged the rather conservative Catalan Orfeos, or choral society, bourgeois choral societies, to include these overtly communist works by Eisler in their musical programs. Nevertheless, Gerard emphasized in his essay that he was interested only in the musical dimension of these works and not in the propagandistic dimension. In 1932, Gerard wrote to Schoenberg that he had recently composed two pieces for male choir. These pieces for male choir had not survived, and I wonder whether Gerard could have taken Eisler's choral works for workers as a compositional model in some ways. Of Gerard's surviving works, the two sardanas from 1929 are a product of the Neue Sachlichkeit. That Gerard decided to compose for Kobla precisely in this time, in the late 1920s, and not before or later, was not coincidental, I think, but it was a consequence of the anti-romantic trends of the post-war era. The sound of the Kobla perfectly fitted into the tendencies of the 20s that rejected the colossal romantic symphonism and the too expressive sound of the strings. Modernist composers preferred then, in the 20s, small chamber ensembles and the more restrained sound of wind instruments. This here is a list of some significant modernist pieces from the 1920s composed for wind ensembles or ensembles of mostly winds. As an example of how a kobla sounds, I have chosen the central part of Juli Garreta's very popular sardana Juni, which reminds me, this part, very much of Stravinsky's La Histoire du Soldat. The sound of the kobla was praised by neoclassical composers, most prominently Stravinsky, who wanted to compose several sardanas, but he didn't. The writer, Harry Kesseler, was also fascinated by the sound of the kobla. And he was one of many collaborators of Kurzweil. And David Drew, who was not only a Gerard scholar, but also a Kurzweil scholar, Drew thinks or thought that one of the two ballet projects that Kesseler wrote for Kurzweil in 1927, shortly after a visit to Barcelona, that this project, one of these projects, included sardana music. This project was unrealized, so Kurzweil went ahead with this project. Otto Meyer Serra was a Berlin-born Marxist musicologist, a member of Eisler's circle in Berlin, and one of many theoreticians of the Neue Sachlichkeit. Meyer-Serra defined the contemporary works for Kobla as modern Gebrauchsmusik because this music was composed for specific events to be played outside the concert hall, and it was addressed to all layers of society and not only to the elitist audiences of the bourgeois concert hall. The fact that the Kobla musicians were often semi-professionals or amateurs established also a further link with the music for amateurs of Hindemith and many others of the Neue Sachlichkeit. In this regard, it is important to note that unlike other forms of traditional Catalan music, like for instance the folk songs, the sardanas were all composed very recently, most of them in the late 19th century and early 20th century, and all by known composers. These here are some of the best known, and as you can see, most of them were still living in the 20s. There are, however, two very important differences between the contemporary works for Kobla in the 20s and the music of the Neue Sachlichkeit. The first main difference is that most sardanas were stylistically and harmonically conservative, as most sardana composers didn't want to be original or not in the same grade as the composers of the Neue Sachlichkeit, and they wanted to ascribe to established compositional formulas. The second difference is that unlike the music of the Neue Sachlichkeit, the titles and the lyrics of most sardanas, also in the 1920s, were evocative of landscapes, old traditions, and romantic love, and not of very current sociopolitical aspect of society or urban life. In this regard, it is significant that Gerard called these pieces just sardana with no evocative title, and even once he called them two works in sardana form for wind ensemble. This table shows the instrumentation of Gerard's sardanas. The instrumentation of the second sardana, which is actually the first he composed, was modeled on the instrumentation of Weill's The Threepenny Opera, and in particular of Kurt Weill's arrangement of eight numbers of The Threepenny Opera for a wind ensemble, as we will see. The music of The Threepenny Opera was modeled on the dance music, the jazz music played then in the 1920s in nightclubs in Berlin and in actually in all Western big cities. And there was no orchestra, but the accompaniment to the actors was made by a seven-player jazz band. Kurt Weill's instrumentation was highly influential. Hans Eisler and other German composers of Gerard's generation adopted this instrumentation, often with minor changes in the number of instruments, for several works, primarily for works intended for recording, also gramophone recording or radio broadcasting. Kurt Weill arranged eight numbers of the Threepenny Opera for wind band. The arrangement, this arrangement was premiered and published in early 1929. Gerard owned this copy of the score, and I infer that this work was the main influence in the way Gerard created the instrumentation of the sardana. This table here compares Kurt Weill's and Gerard's instrumentation. The differences between both instrumentation is the replacement of the clarinets by the chirimias in Gerard's work, the inclusion of the horn, and the lack of the alto saxophone, banjo, and piano. The length, structure, time signature, and rhythmic elements, motifs, are traditional sardana elements in this work. The texture of the sardana is halfway between the Schoenbergian linear contrapuntual texture and the homophonic setting that is traditional in sardana music and also in the threepenny opera. Regarding the harmony, there are two versions of the sardana with two different harmonic organization. I have called them version A and B. Version B is the one recorded in 1996, is the one we all know. And version A has been overlooked by scholars so far. The main referential collection in version A is the F major and F Lydian collections. In version B, Gerard exploits a chromatic polarity between F and G flat as tonal centers. The final chord in version A is a F major chord, and the final chord in version V is a superposition or a fusion of a F major and G flat major chord. This exploitation of a semitonal polarity could have been modeled on Bartok's music, in which often two diatonic collections separated by a semitone are superimposed. I don't think that Kurt Weill's music was influential here in terms of harmonic organization, but more analysis are needed to see how what models were had Gerard in terms of harmony. Let's listen to a short excerpt from this sardana. I wonder why Gerard composed two sardanas, and I wonder which version he composed first. And I also wonder which of both versions was played in the old Gerard concert in late 1929 in Barcelona. As a matter of fact, Luis Millet was very critical of the instrumentation and some rhythmic elements in the sardana, but he made no comments on the harmony or say nothing about dissonant harmonies or something like that. So I really wonder which one of both versions was premiered. These pieces in sardana form are Gerard's response to the German fascination in the 20s for the incorporation of elements of urban popular music in pieces of art music. In Gerard's case, these elements came not from jazz or the so-called light music like foxtrot, shimmy, tango, and so on, but it came from the sardana genre, which was also a genre of urban popular music at the time. Besides an overt expression of Catalan identity, the sardanas are a product of the German modernism trends of the Weimar era. The sardanas are the only work, I think, that is influenced by this or directly influenced by these currents, by the Neue Sachlichkeit. Although Gerard spoke always highly of the music of the Neue Sachlichkeit, he did not compose music for children, for the radio, for amateur musicians, for workers, and not this type of pieces to be played outside the concert hall. And unlike the German Zeit operas and political cantatas of the pre-Nazi period, Gerard Stage works of the 30s were not about current political urban topics, but about age-old myths and rights. The main reason for this discordance between Gerard's championing of the tenets of the Neue Sachlichkeit in the 30s and his own creative work is, I think, the very different socio-political, economic, cultural, and above all, institutional context of interwar Spain and Germany, and more specifically, Barcelona and Berlin in the 20s and 30s. But if we observe Gerard's output with more perspective, his career, we see that the end of Gerard's studies with Arnold Schönberg and the year 1929 marked the beginning of a new creative phase in which Gerard abandoned the genres of absolute music. In the 1930s, Gerard no longer composed string quartets or wind quintets, but mostly works for the stage and with a program. It was not until the 1950s when he returned to serial composition and composed again string quartets, chamber music, and now also symphonies. Seen in retrospect, this departure from absolute music or pure music was a consequence of the interwar modernism trends that rejected the notions of artistic elitism and autonomy of art. I would like to finish my presentation by thanking Olga Gerr and Richard Andrews for their help in my research. And also thank you to you all for listening.